Hey, this is Jamie from Stonemaier Games. I am the designer of Scythe and Expeditions, two games set in the 1920-plus universe created by and illustrated by Jakub Rozalski. And today, I'm going to talk about a little bit about how the two games compare, because Expeditions is a sequel to Scythe that was designed from the ground up, from the story, from the mechanisms, from the world building, to the characters. Everything was designed to be a sequel to the story of Scythe, which wrapped up with three expansions. And so I wanted today to talk about 10 of the, I would say, the best received, the most beloved aspects of Scythe, and how those elements influence the design and the creation of Expeditions. I'm going to focus on showing you things from Expeditions. If you're not familiar with Scythe, feel free to check out many other videos and many other photos about that. But I wanted to keep the visual focus on Expeditions today. So in no real particular order, let's start out with the encounters. In Scythe, as you move around the board, you can have these encounters where you draw a card, you see a first-person perspective of the scene that you've encountered, and you have the choice between three different things. You make a choice that that can impact you in different ways. And in Expeditions, the comparison to this are, there's a few actually comparisons, but the main comparison are the locations. So some of the locations, in the south, start out face up on the board. But some of the locations, central and northern locations, like this one right here, this is a central location, as you can see by the sea up here. This is a location that will start out face down on the map, on the table. And when you uncover it, when you arrive here for the first time, you will reveal this location. And so this is kind of the first perspective view of this location. This is the encounter that you're having there. You are encountering this location. And the unexpected element here, similar to encounters, is that oftentimes one of the core things you're doing on your turn is gathering from a location. You're gathering the benefits of a location. And so if you're moving to an unknown location, you don't know what the gather benefits on that location are. And so that's, they're always good. They're not trying to hurt you. But there is a gather benefit there that you don't know what it is. So that's kind of what you're encountering. The free thing that you're getting if you explore, if you choose to gather, is the gather benefit on this location. And along with that, a few other things happen when you explore. One, you get a map token. So you get a little benefit for saying, hey, you did explore this. These are similar to the encounter tokens in Scythe. In fact, we used pretty much the same exact icon. Here's the map icon there. From Expeditions. So you gain that token. That can be a way that you can score glory. You can achieve glory in Expeditions. Also, when you arrive at this location, you're going to put corruption on the location. So there's a little bit of a bag reveal process. You'll reveal some corruption tokens from a bag and put them on that location. The last element that is compared to the encounter system in Scythe, is that throughout the game in Expeditions, you are gathering, or one of the types of cards you can gather are quest cards. So you can find quests throughout the land. Here's a quest right here to trap the zombies. And every location has two quests associated with it. They come up randomly. They're in a big deck of cards. There's a big deck of cards that holds items, meteorites, and quests. If you see this quest, if you want, you can pick it up. You can see that it has some abilities here. It has a core value up here. It has an ability here if you place a green worker on the card when you play it. But it also is a quest, meaning that if you want, you can find and go to location 7, which is in the central area. And if you go there and you use the solve ability, which is found on your character and other places in the game, and you spend this cost, you can gain this benefit. So these quests are tied to the locations in a somewhat similar way to the encounters in Scythe. So it's kind of a thematic touch. This is something that you're going to this location to do. It's part of your story in the game. You've decided to go to location 7 and trap the zombies. And here's the cost, here are the benefits, those are the consequences of doing so. And when you do that, you no longer have this card to play. You'll tuck this under your player mat, which I'll talk about a little bit later. So yeah, those are the comparisons to the encounters in Scythe. Number two is the asymmetry. Scythe has a lot of asymmetry, more asymmetry than Expeditions. In Scythe, you have an asymmetric pairing. You're pairing a mech mat, your faction mat, with a player mat, with where all your actions are. I toned down the asymmetry a little bit in Expeditions. I wanted a little bit more of the asymmetry to come from the decisions you make during the game rather than what you were set up with at the beginning of the game. But there is still an asymmetric pairing in Expeditions. Part of that asymmetric pairing is the mech mat that you receive. So here's an example of a mech mat. This shows what mech miniature you'll have in the game. It has an asymmetric ability. Again, not as distinct as Scythe. It is a very specific ability, but the reason I'm kind of hedging here a little bit is that with Scythe, the asymmetry in the game is a lot of fun. It helps replayability, but it often, or it can lead to some imbalances in the game, some slight imbalances for certain combinations. And so we heavily playtested Expeditions. We were trying to avoid any such imbalances in this game. They might still arise. We'll find out once 10,000, 20,000 people have played this game, but playtesting indicates that we are pretty darn balanced with these characters and these mechs. But I toned down the asymmetry just in case. I wanted for that to be less of a concern in Expeditions. So you have an asymmetric ability here. That's the only asymmetric element of the mech. And with this, you pair a choice of characters. So you'll choose a character. You can randomize this or you can choose. And so let's see, here's a character pairing here. So when you choose your character, you're actually choosing a pairing of a character and their specific companion. So these aren't randomized together. If you are playing with Volton, that means you are playing with Vesna and vice versa. If you choose Vesna, you are playing with Volton. These are the two cards that you start out with in your hand at the beginning of the game, the only two cards. So you'll pair these randomly with, say, this mech mat, and this is your asymmetric pairing in the game. The asymmetry on these characters, there are slight differences between the characters on their core values up here, and also their abilities are similar. Like all character abilities have to do with solving, but they also have a unique ability down there. And all companion benefits have to deal with vanquishing, but they also have a unique benefit as well. So this is the asymmetric pairing as compared to Scythe. Number three is the tension. There's a lot of tension inside that comes from the threat of combat. Combat when it rarely but happens sometimes in Scythe, and also the tension of getting to the factory first and having your first choice of factory cards. In Expeditions, there are a couple examples of tension, but I should emphasize right off the bat that there is no combat between players in Expeditions. Mechs are not fighting each other in Expeditions. You are all competing to have the most glory of all the explorers that go through this area of Tunguska, and to have the most money at the end as well. But you're not fighting each other. You're fighting instead the corruption that I mentioned. When you reveal a location, this location is seeded with corruption tokens that look like this. And one of the core things that you're doing in the game when you're spending guile and power is to remove corruption. You're vanquishing corruption from this land. So the tension is, are you going to be the one to remove the corruption or not? Because corruption is a great source for points. These tokens are worth $2 at the end of the game, two coins, and they can they're good for other reasons as well. They're good for achieving glory. And so certain corruption are easier to remove than others. There are three value corruption tokens like this that only cost 3 power to remove. So those are easier to remove. They're all worth $2, whereas some of them require 5, so 3, 4, or 5. So some are easier to remove than others. So there's a point of tension there. Are you going to be the first to remove this corruption from the locations? There's also a 20 value corruption token that you'll find on location 20. So this requires 10 guile plus 10 power, but in itself is worth a glory if you are the one to remove this. So there's tension of which player will be the one to do that. That's kind of the equivalent of the factory in this game, this location 20, where the climax happens, and where you have this unique corruption token there. There's also, I'm looking at my notes here, there's also a race to the end of the game. You are trying to race to be the first player to place 4 glory, to achieve 4 glory on the base camp mat. And so if you are pushing towards that end of the game better, more efficiently, more optimizing than other players, then you're going to probably end up with more stars there and will score more points at the end of the game thanks to those stars. It's not the only path to victory, but there is a path to victory there that leads to tension. There's also all these cards that I've mentioned, the items, the meteorites, the quest cards, these are face up. There are 5 face up cards within the map itself. And so there's tension to be the player. Like if there's a card that you want, Like a worker placement game, essentially. If you want that card, you need to go get it. You need to get that card. There's tension of, will that card still be available when it comes back to my turn? There's also tension in that way for the locations themselves. If I really need to get a purple worker, I think there are only two locations that have the possessed purple workers. If I really need to get one, I need to go to this location. I need to go here to go gather that benefit at this location. Also, if I want to reveal a location in the first place, so this is an unrevealed location, that's how I get maps. That's the main and primary way to get map tokens in this game. So I need to actually go to that location and collect that map before another player grabs it. So I think I've hit all the main points of tension. Yeah, so it's a lot of like being the first player to do something in the game, to grab the card that you want, to go to that location that you need to be at right now, whether it's to gather something or even to complete a quest there. If I have a quest for location 10, and I want to complete it, I need to go to location 10 to take care of that. So lots of different points of tension in the game, but not direct combat between players. Number four, I kind of alluded to this in a second, multiple paths to victory. So I'm going to show you the base camp mat. This is actually changing a little bit. The format of this mat is changing. I have the early pre-production copy. Let me see if I can find it here amongst all my different tiles. So I want to mention that the format for this mat is changing a little bit. The purpose of it is not. So these are the different glory categories in the game. You can see the font's a little small here. We enhanced that in the final version of this mat. But the meaning is all the same. So one of the main paths to victory is to place glory tokens on this mat. And you can, like in similar to Scythe, where you have the different stars that you're placing on the triumph track, now we have this glory track where you are either solving four quests, you're melding four meteorites, you're upgrading four items, you are going to location 20 and vanquishing that 20 value token, you're gathering at least seven corruption tokens, some of the normal standard corruption tokens, you have eight cards, you have seven workers, or you have five map tokens. You only have four stars, so you can only complete up to four of these different categories. So similar to Scythe, you're kind of picking different paths to victory in any particular game and deciding how you want to get points from them. There's also, you're scoring coins that you gather during the game, so there might be cards that give you coins, locations that give you coins. Also, any upgraded item cards also have a coin value on them. And just by clearing corruption, by really being really good at vanquishing, you can get a lot of points because you're getting 2 points per corruption token. So those are kind of the paths to get points, to get these coins that you're gathering to actually have the best score. But there's also different paths that you can take as you build towards the end of the game, as you're working towards progression. This mat is the same on both sides. You're kind of choosing, like, am I going to upgrade my engine? I'll talk about engine building in a second, but I'm going to focus on upgrading by melding or by having workers that always are able to activate my different abilities, upgrading items, by solving quests. Am I going to focus on quests in this game? So the way you choose to focus in the game in terms of progression is a big part of your path towards the end of the game. So we're almost halfway through here. Hopefully this is going well for you. I'm enjoying talking about these comparisons. Next up, I mentioned engine building. Now we're on engine building here. So those are the different ways that you can upgrade your mat. You can focus on, if you slot a quest card, here I'll show you what this looks like. Let me give you a few examples. So yeah, if you slot this quest card under your mat, it upgrades something that I'll talk about in a second. I'll talk about the impact of popularity of these quests. But you also, whenever you solve using your character specifically, you gain the core value of any previous card that you've solved. And also, you're getting these one-time benefits when you solve. So these are the three different reasons that solving can be really beneficial towards you. For you, not just right away, but also in terms of engine building for the end of the game. There are also, let's get an example of a meteorite card. So here is a meteorite card. So if you're focusing on meteorites, they all have abilities that are unique to them. Each of the types of cards are designed a little bit differently. Meteorites are a little different than items in terms of their abilities. Quests also have different abilities than the other two types of cards. But if you're going to meld meteorites, that's when, let's see if I can get, I did this wrong last time. Okay, here we go. Here's the right way to orient it. When you meld a meteorite under your mech, you activate all meld abilities. So if I've already melded two meteorites and then I meld this meteorite, not only do I gain this benefit, which says gain $1 per four value corruption token that you have. for a max of $3. There's always a max on these, so you can't just completely abuse them. But not only am I gaining this benefit, but I am also at that moment gaining the same benefits on the other two cards that have already melded. So you're getting more and more points every time you meld, and you're hoping to kind of combo together some of those cards so that maybe if you are focused on corruption, that you're getting four value corruption tokens, and that maybe some of your other melded meteorites have to deal with corruption tokens as well. And then items. Items are the last, the last way that you can upgrade your mech on an ongoing basis. Let's get an example of an item here. Here's one. Here's the Deceptor Crystal. The Deceptor Crystal has, if you upgrade this under your mat, so normally when you play a card, you can place a worker on it to activate the ability. So all this stuff down here comes from placing that worker. However, if you upgrade the card, you slide it under your mat to cover that worker, to cover this part of the card. So you don't actually get this part of the benefit anymore. But from then on, you have this ability active for the rest of the game. This one says, whenever you gather, you may pay one guile to include a benefit covered by corruption on your location. So that's referring to this. So if this location still has corruption covering this benefit, you can't gather that benefit, but this card gives you a way around that. So you can upgrade your engine by sliding these cards under your map, by upgrading these item cards. The other big engine building element of the game is which cards that you decide to keep, the cards that you decide not to meld or upgrade or solve for the quests. So which cards do you keep in your hand and in your active row? Which cards are you actually playing throughout the game? That's a big part of the engine that you're building throughout the game as well. And also there are the workers. So to activate these abilities on the cards, you need worker meeples. Here are some worker meeples right here. So you need these worker meeples. So these are part of the engine. So you might have a bunch of cards that focus on green workers. And so you might just be a little better at getting green workers throughout the game and focus on those green abilities. There are also a lot of cards that look at the colors of the cards. The colors refer to those worker types. So those are, let me see if I missed anything for engine building. Oh, I should mention here, so the mech mats. This is the example of the mech mat I was using this game. So this is where you're sliding all these cards. You're slotting quest cards up here. You're slotting item cards over here. You're slotting your melding meteorites down here. And in the previous video I filmed about expeditions, there was a little bit of concern about how easy is it to actually slide cards under this mat, because it's not a dual layered mat. It's a single layered mat. And my answer is, it really is very easy. It's a fairly thick mat. It's easy to lift off the table just a little bit without causing any of the three tokens on this mat to slide around. However, I heard the concerns expressed in the comments of that video, and we are adding something to the game, just a little change, an optional change. We're gonna add these little stickers that if you want to, you can put them in the four corners of the back of your mech. And these stickers are designed to be tall enough, they're riser stickers, to lift this mat slightly off the table so that you don't have to lift it off the table to slide a card. Rather, the mat will be raised off the table a little bit so you can just slide the card in there. You don't have to lift anything up. It'll just slide right under there, under the table. Completely optional. In the rulebook, we even say, try to play a game or two without the risers, because once you put them on here, they're permanent. They're permanent stickers. But they're going to be there for you to address that concern in case that is a concern for you. Popularity. The popularity multiplier was a big thing in Scythe. Like, how do the choices that you make throughout the game that impact popularity, namely on encounters and with combat, or anytime you're forcing workers off the land, forcing these people off their land, how does that impact your popularity? And at the end of the game, the way that you score for different categories is impacted by your popularity at the end of the game. In expeditions, the corollary are the quest cards themselves. I mentioned this a little bit earlier. So if you have some quest cards, if you ignore quests, say you ignore quests completely, you don't go after any quest throughout the game, your multiplier at the end of the game is that for every star that you have, every glory star that you have is worth $5. So default of $5. However, if you have one, if you've achieved one quest, if you solved one quest in the game, suddenly then you're a little bit more popular. People of this land like you a little bit more, and every glory token that you have is worth $6, just a little increment. So you're a little bit more popular. And then jumps up from there. If you have two quests solved at the end of the game, you're now decently popular. Every one of your glory stars, your stars, your glory, will score $8. And finally, if you have three or four, so the max is four, three or four, three or four. That's worth, that means that each of your glory tokens are worth $10. So it's it's doubling it from the value of not doing popularity. So this was a tight range design here because we wanted to make it possible for players to not focus on quests and still have a viable path to victory. But at the same time, we wanted it to be lucrative if you decide to pursue this game. If you are focusing on moving around the map and solving these quests, picking up quests and actually solving them, can be quite lucrative in terms of how popular you are with the people who you have helped by solving these quests. So that's popularity. Next up, we have, what is this, number seven, resources on the map. Yeah, this is something that I think someone's forgotten about Scythe, but I think it's a key element of why Scythe works so well. The resources that you earn, that you trade for, and that you produce in Scythe are kept on the map itself. They're kept on the territories. And in expeditions, the corollary here is that they're the only resources in the game are guile and power. And these are tracked on your mech mat. Guile and power over here. However, I mentioned earlier that the cards that you're picking up, the cards are within the map itself. They are found within the map. I can't really hold this up to you because they're like in between the tiles themselves. So these cards are found within the map itself. The idea being that you actually have to move around. If you see an item you want, you have to move around and go get it. You have to go explore and find that item. You have to dig up that meteorite. You have to accept the quest from someone at a specific place. And they're in between the tiles on the table itself. The nice element here, too, is that because there's some blank spaces between tiles in the game, it makes those tiles easier to flip over when you need to reveal them. But yeah, so this is the corollary to resources being kept on the map. The cards themselves are kept within the map in expeditions. And also I wanted to emphasize, there are 90 cards in this deck. Let's see if I can show you the full deck so you can see how big this deck is. They are all new illustrations that Jakob created. So 90 card deck. It actually doesn't look that big here, but 90 cards. It's a lot of cards. I might be missing a few more. Oh yeah, I am missing a few more. 90 cards. It's a lot of unique cards. You are only ever going to go through, even in a five-player game, at most, maybe 30 to 40% of this deck per game. The entire thing is shuffled. So there is a ton of variability in terms of which cards are seen in this deck and in any given game and in the order in which they come out. You might see that Brave Stone. You might see this Brave Stone, but you might see it one game really early in the game, and you might see it another game late in the game, or you might not see it at all. So there's a ton of variability there in that big deck of cards. Number eight, what are we on? Eight, the animals in the mechs. And so this is a little thing. I kind of mentioned it earlier, the animal companions. Here's Volton. Here's Changa. Here are a few examples of the animals. So in Scythe, the animals were physically attached to the characters. So they were one in the same with the characters themselves. And in Expeditions, we tried to do something a little bit different. I wanted players to feel like they were actually engaging with and I don't want to say using, but being able to play and do something specific with a companion, an animal companion, that is different from what they're doing with their character. And that's why they're different. That's why they're different cards. So you can play your character card or you can play your animal card. They're both in your hand. You can choose when you want to play them. So they have their own, I guess, unique personality. You can now say, I'm playing Volton, instead of just saying, I'm playing Vesna and Volton. So we were able to split them up a little bit. And also, the mech comparison. So let's use an example here. So in Scythe, one of the cool things about Scythe, I think, is that you have these four different mechs, and you are choosing, each one has an asymmetric ability, and you're choosing when to unlock those abilities. That isn't part of Expeditions. You have the ability from the beginning of the game, and you're upgrading your mech. That's how you're kind of changing how your mech works throughout the game in Expeditions. However, I am always happy with the size of the mechs in size. So here's an example of a mech here. This is one of the metal mechs. And let me show you the mech that I've been talking about today. So this is the plastic version of this mech. Because in Expeditions, we wanted players to feel like, hey, you have this one specific mech that's just yours. And this is your moving home, essentially, as you move around Expeditions. This is your base. We wanted them to be dramatically big. We wanted them to be big for that reason, and also big to show that when you have a mech on a location, that you are the only mech that can be at that location, only one mech per location at any given time. So we needed them to be dramatically big. I've already spoiled it. Here's the size of that mech. Here is the size of the mechs in size. So this is what I was getting at. I think the mechs inside are decently sized, especially since you have four of them. In Expeditions, you have one big mech, and they are really big. This is the tallest mech. You can see how big that mech is here. They are very big mechs. I'm sure there are games with other bigger mechs, but I wanted dramatically big mechs. Jakob did too, and so he designed these five mechs to go in the game. So they are these big mechs that you're controlling that you kind of feel a direct attachment to. This is your mech that you're moving around. You're inside that mech as you move through this land. Number nine, we have the art and the world. I mentioned that Jakob, all illustrations in this game are complete. There's all 90 of these cards. There are the 12 character and companion pairings here. The 12 of these. So all of these, this is 12 more illustrations. There's unique locations for all 20 locations. There are also unique locations for every different mech mat and the box. There's so much art that Jakob created for this world to create a sense of the unknown, of danger. It's a little creepy because you're moving to this land where these meteorites have fallen upon the land. The meteor has fallen, spread these meteorites over the land, and these meteorites have kind of corrupted the land and awakened something ancient and dangerous and scary. So it's a little bit of a darker tone than in Scythe. And Jakob created all this that also feels like part of the Scythe world, that we know. And a lot of it is, it's beautiful. I really love what he did with this game. And he tied it to the world of Scythe. So here's something called the Tesla pistol. So there's technology that was picked up from the events of Scythe that have impacted this world. Here's a few other examples of cards here. But there's also new technology that people are using these meteorite shards for to create. But it's also awakened some other stuff that's new and supernatural and dangerous in a way that wasn't in Scythe. So it's very much the same 1920 plus world, but later. The world has changed a little bit since the events of Scythe. Let's see if there's anything else about the art and the world. I just have a note here about more of a sense of the unknown. And that is really it. In fact, I would almost encourage you when you open your copy here, maybe don't look through all the cards. Let yourself discover the cards as you're playing, as you're venturing out in this world. And there's also the unknown element from these face-down tiles. You will always have the same 20 tiles in the game. That's important because there are quest cards tied to specific locations. But the order in which they'll come out, the random placement on the board of those tiles or on the table of those tiles will change each game. So that order of operations can make a pretty big impact on how you play each game of Expeditions. And last, the action selection. I probably could have talked about this earlier. I'll end with a kind of a dry mechanical thing, but I think it's a pretty neat element of the game. So in Scythe, the action selection mechanism, you had this player mat, and you would choose a section of that player mat and activate the top row benefit if you wanted, and generally you do. And then if you could afford it, you would gain the bottom row benefit of that section. But importantly, for most of the factions in Scythe, you could not choose the same section on back-to-back turns. You have to choose one or another. You have to choose a different section to activate. So you can't just do the same thing over and over again, except for the Roosevelt faction. The comparison here is this shifting action selection system in Expeditions. So for most of the game, most turns of the game, you will have an action token. Let's see if I can get one out of here so I can actually show you. For most turns, you will be shifting an action token around up here. In the final version of this map, to make it very clear, there's going to be a rectangle around these three actions: move, play, and gather. And so at the beginning of your turn, if my action token was on move at the beginning of my turn, say I shifted over to play, and then I get to take the two exposed actions. So I'm covering play, so I don't get to take play, but I can see move and I can see gather. So those are the two actions that I get to take on my turn in any order that I want. I can move first and then go gather there. I can gather first and then I can move. You must take those actions if possible. And so a lot of the game is spent shifting around this token to gain a combination of two abilities. You can see the comparison to Scythe here. You're gaining two core things on your turn, but you can't do the same exact thing on back-to-back turns. And at some point, you may have played a bunch of cards, used a bunch of workers, and you might decide, okay, it's time for me to refresh. And when you do that, you'll move your token down here. You'll take a very short, very basic refresh turn. Unless sometimes you have an ability, you might have some ongoing abilities to say, whenever you refresh, gain this benefit. The reason these red arrows are here, though, is that there are a few times where it's mandatory to move your token to a certain space. So if at the beginning of your turn, if your token is on refresh, you must move it here. And so on a turn after a refresh turn, you gain all three benefits, all three actions. You get to move, play, and gather. So the turn after a refresh turn, you get a super powerful turn. You get a supercharged turn. And then the arrows are there to remind you that on a turn after that, you got to move your arrow into this rectangular box where, again, your token will spend most of the game moving around within the invisible rectangular box that you can't see there yet, but will be there on the final map. So that's the flow of the game, this action selection system that's kind of a distilled version of the Scythe system, but still captures that unique feel of that action selection system in Scythe. Those are my 10 comparisons. I'm sorry this video ran a little bit longer than I thought. 30 minutes was definitely longer than I thought I'd talk about this. But yeah, as you can see, like every element of Expeditions was designed to capture that feeling of Scythe. Same world, same art, but to tell that story a little differently and to give you different mechanical choices, different ways to progress and engine build and encounter and have asymmetry that will be familiar to Scythe, but not the same as Scythe. Let me know your questions in the comments below. I've enjoyed talking about this and I will enjoy talking about it with you in the comments. Thanks.